News First, Newsline, with Faraz Shaukatali.
And a wonderful morning to you. This is Newsline, live as always, from the News First studios in Dawson Street in Colombo. And a rather pleasant morning today. And of course, we are graced this morning by the presence of the Minister of Skills Development and Vocational Training, Mr. Chandima Birakode. Very good morning to you, Minister.
Good morning, Faraz.
Appreciate you coming on the program. And the question I'm posing to you today is Sri Lanka on its way to becoming a nation of three-wheel drivers or a nation full of skilled people and professional people?
Well, that's a very good question. In fact, the issue of being a three-wheeler driver is a huge problem for the new generation, for the parents, and also for anyone by the road.
I think we must first acknowledge that there's nothing wrong in being a three-wheeler driver, but I think the question really is, why is it that almost every other young person that you meet feels that they've accomplished life's ultimate goal, having left school, that they've got a three-wheeler?
Yeah, I mean, I don't agree with you with the fact that it's nothing wrong in becoming a three-wheeler driver, because when you have talent, when there is a way forward in this country, when better employment is available, why should you become a three-wheeler driver and kill yourself? Is my issue, my question. We have, as a ministry, we have looked at this, and we have a program in place. In fact, we launched Sri Lanka Skills about a couple of months back. And we have, in writing, we have launched 10 plus 1 program, the way forward for skills development and vocational training. Among the 11 top items that we are pursuing, issue of three-wheeler drivers is one of the foremost. We have now, in fact, the curriculum and the program is almost finalized. We'll be starting very soon, hopefully before the end of next month. We'll be starting a program for the existing three-wheeler drivers to learn a vocation. Now, for instance, like every one of us are faced with an issue of getting a plumber when there is a leak.
That's right, or a mason, or an electrician.
Yeah, when there is an issue at home,
waiting for months for a guy to come in and repair my
absolutely
answer, you know?
Yeah, so we are now planning to teach the three-wheeler drivers, those who would like to be an electrician, a plumber, who would like to be a handyman. You know, in other countries you get handyman. So we are trying to teach them to be the handyman. Or a hairdresser. And while doing their three-wheeler job, the issue is, you have, due to people get pushed into become three-wheeler drivers due to financial issues. You buy a three-wheel and sit in a junction, you can get some income. Certainly we can't shut them out at once.
No, it's fine. That's why we say that there's nothing.
So what we are trying to do is to,
there should be a limit.
What we are trying to do is to get them to, like, get into other vocations, like to run as a, to work as a electrician while doing your three-wheeler job. Then, and you have the accessibility. Now, if you know that there is a three-wheeler guy in your junction, like, you know, the usually the three-wheeler guys in your closest junction is known to the neighborhood. If you know the guy is a electrician or he is a plumber, then you will always, like, you know, okay, there is an issue, you get this man down. Eventually, when he feels that he can get a better income by doing the electrician's job or plumber's job, he will move away from the three-wheeler job, and he'll start start functioning as a electrician. At the same time, the youth and the school children, they are still in the dark as to what they can do if they lose like to pass, if they fail to pass their exams, whether it's
ordinary. No, that's it, isn't it, Minister? We need to inculcate at a very early stage that is more life beyond the three-wheeler.
Yeah, absolutely. That's another key thing that we are planning to do. In fact, I have informed the Minister of Education, also had discussed with him as well, to set up skills clubs in schools.
Right.
So if you set up a skills club, then like students are very keen. Like in school, you get students who would like to be leaders.
Where did you go to school?
I was at St. Aloysius College, Gaul, and Nalanda College, Kalam.
Right. When you were at school, did you have metalwork classes and so on?
Well, at Nalanda we had.
Right.
There was a weather kamare.
Yeah.
Loha weather kamare.
Right.
And
but it was fun. But it you participated, so it was fun. But I wonder if other schools around the country also have these things.
These are things that they had started long years back. I think I looked into it. It's not there anymore.
Right.
The Sarvodaya movement has started off at Nalanda.
Right.
So during that time, they had launched these programs and they were still going on.
Right.
But I still don't know of a person who has taken to that vocation, having studied.
Right. Yes. Yeah. Yes. That's the other thing, because sometimes it's.
But you become a handy man, like in school when you get the exposure.
Yeah.
Then at home you can, attend to something small.
Yeah. Right. But the thing is that Minister Iran Vikramaratne said he caused a lot of consternation, actually. I'm not so sure that he realized what's going to happen. But he suggested that people from, say, from India would be able to come here to work in the ICT industry because apparently we didn't have enough people. But my point is this. Instead of that's a means to an end. You need to develop our country, our industry, and be proud to be Sri Lankan. You've got to really take that. It's just not a nice soundbite saying, proud to be Sri Lankan, and when you're at a cricket match or whatever it is. It should go beyond all that, and it should go far deeper. And people ought to really say, look, I'm a registered Mason, or I'm a registered whatever, and I belong to a professional body, I'm trained, I'm on the government website, and you need to sort of inculcate pride.
Yeah, that's a very good question. I must tell you, it's frightening, not only IT personnel.
Yeah.
Even as of now, there are thousands of Indian, Indonesians, Bangladesh, Bengali people, and from various other countries who are working as masons, electricians, plumbers in most of these construction sites.
That's right.
For they are being paid about 80,000 to 90,000 rupees, whereas Sri Lankans we find going to the Middle East for 45,000-50,000 or even less.
Oh, indeed, it's about 30,000.
Yeah. So, and at the same time, I must answer your question. We have Sri Lanka Skills. We have a website now. We have created a website where, and there is a hotline as well in place. So anyway, we are inviting every qualified mason, electrician, plumber, or whoever who has NVQ4 qualification. We are going to register all the students who are passing out from our institutes in that website.
And we have enough spaces in these institutes, is it?
Absolutely.
Right.
That I will address later. There is a concern as well.
Yeah.
So what we are now planning is to register them all in that website and to launch a mobile app in time to come, so that you will know, well, like when you access the closest electrician.
That's right, how to access. Everybody's got a smartphone these days.
Yeah, closest plumber to access. So, and also at the same time, we are studying into setting up councils, of which you take the plumbers, there will be a Sri Lanka Plumbers Council, which will be affiliated to other international plumbers councils as well, so that the standards will be maintained. This will benefit not only the employee, the plumber, but also the employer. Now today, another common issue is, like, you get hold of a plumber from the wayside, he messes up, he sometimes can mess up things,
and it'll go,
but if he messes up, you can't track him, you can't hold him responsible. But here, if you are a registered plumber of a council,
then you can.
Then he can be stripped off.
Yeah.
He doesn't conduct himself up to the required standards.
Yes.
So it's a win-win situation. And the quality. And also, we are going to introduce, we have now identified the colors of international uniforms.
Yeah.
There is an internationally accepted uniform and a color for the respective vocation. Like for plumbers, there is one color. Electricians, there is one color.
Yeah.
So we are going to give them, when they pass out, give them those uniforms.
Yeah.
And also, we are from I have requested from the Minister of Finance to be included in the budget, to, in order to inculcate young students to get into these vocations, to give them a, like, these are invariably due to poverty, people get into three-wheel jobs or whatever.
Yeah.
During the time of their training, also to pay about 5,000 rupees from the government.
Right.
Like, off government funds.
Hmm.
And then also during their apprenticeship, internship, while they are working for an employer, state to pocket out some money for them to sustain.
Mm-hmm.
So that there will be an encouragement for the students, for the younger generation to take to these vocations, because the future there is bright.
Yeah.
It's available, and then those qualifications that where they can get international acceptance.
Yeah,
we are trying to introduce such accreditations also into our courses, so that there is like their future is not only restricted to limited to Sri Lanka, but they can be employed there as well.
The other thing, Minister, is that you can't but help notice that the investment in the leisure, the hospitality and leisure industry, hotels and so on, is enormous now. Everywhere you go, you have people building hotels and so on, and these means rooms, and these rooms need to be serviced. And the level of English speaking, which is whether we like it or not, is the international language. And the level of the English proficiency is appalling. It's actually very worrying, because it's well and good inviting the Shangri-Las and the Hyatts and Hiltons of this world to come over here. But we need to be able to supply them with the right kind of workforce. Otherwise, you'll find that whilst they're negotiating their entry, they may say, well, we need to bring some people from abroad because you guys don't have it.
Yeah, that's all.
What are you doing about languages and stuff?
Yeah, we are addressing that as well.
Yeah.
We have a proposal to set up a language laboratory in each divisional secretariat area. So that students will have accessibility not only to learn English, but to learn Chinese, Russian, German, French, because now you get a lot of Chinese tourists coming
absolutely.
Who are not fluent in, who cannot understand English at all.
Yeah.
And there are so many Russians who are coming.
Yeah.
Of course, the Germans and French also. You get some of them who can't understand.
No, yes, it's not no harm. So,
yeah. So we are trying to teach all those languages. And in fact, we have now at NIBM, there is a English program. We have an English faculty.
Right.
And in every vocational training institute, we are trying to teach English to every student who's studying other vocations as well. And especially in hospitality trade.
Yeah.
We are, now our Hangama Hotel School is almost completed.
Yeah.
We'll be commissioning it very soon.
Right.
And there is one in Achuveli.
Yeah.
And another one in the north.
Yes.
So we will be launching those very soon. English and other languages will be a must in the curriculum that they are going to introduce.
One of our viewers is asking us, why not have a special project to fill thousands of vacancies in free trade zones? Is that true?
Well, it's like this. We do have programs like we are now presently, after I took over the ministry, I appointed as my board members representatives from the industry,
right,
like, and the private sector.
Right.
It's like a 80-20% breakup.
Mm-hmm.
80% from the industry and the private sector, about 20% comes from the civil society, like like a few political appointees.
Yes, you need a few political.
Yeah, parties. From like those who are with the people, they will say.
Maybe some people who help you organize and so on.
Yeah, like they are also qualified people now.
Yeah.
A few, most of them have a legal background plus exposure in civil society.
Right.
Some of them, like a couple of them, have been in at Pradesh Sabha level in politics, but at the same
time. Have you got anybody who is just there because he's your friend?
No, no one. But my friends are there, they are all qualified.
They may be friends, but they may also have the other skills.
Absolutely. I have appointed all those who are from the industry, those who possess qualifications.
Yeah.
So their interaction, their contribution, resolves most of those issues.
Are you personally opposed to the floodgates of overseas workers coming into Sri Lanka being opened? Would you oppose such a move to allow?
Well, now in Sri Lanka, we have a huge issue of unemployment.
Yeah.
The government always talks about providing 1 million employment opportunities.
That's right.
So, and also Sri Lanka's the biggest income earner is foreign employment.
Yeah.
And our most valuable resource is human resource. We don't have anything else.
That's our point.
Yeah.
A number of people, wherever you go, they'll tell you that they want, why can't we, okay, we can export, but we can export professional, skilled people.
Yeah.
So obviously then the money that they would remit back here will be greater than what is being done now. And no disrespect whatsoever, much respect actually to these people who are out there at great social cost. Because when the ladies go out there, their children and their husbands are left, there are huge social problems.
Yeah.
And it's changing, slowly but surely, changing the fabric of our society.
Yeah. So this is, we have identified the issues. Now, for instance, we give various certificates, degrees in Sri Lanka, but most of those are not acceptable outside, because you have to get professional accreditation in those respective countries.
Yeah.
What we are now trying to do is to give that topping. We have they have done the cake, but the topping is not acceptable to those countries. We are now getting into affiliations with those countries, with those universities that are acceptable internationally, to grant degrees, diplomas that are acceptable. In fact, now even coming week we are affiliating NIBM with the University of Coventry.
Mm-hmm.
And I was in Calgary negotiating with University of Calgary, which is like within first 200 universities, to start a degree program with NSBM and NIBM and also Skills Development Fund. So we are like working out those.
Yes.
So finally, I believe with those institutes coming in,
yeah,
we will be able to send quite a number of Sri Lankans to top jobs outside Sri Lanka. Now, if you take the energy industry,
yeah,
we don't have a proper qualification in Sri Lanka. So we are trying to introduce energy engineering.
It sounds all wonderful that all these things are in place. But how much of it is, you know, we have so many ministers,
yeah,
right? How much of your work is impeded, not impeded, but overflows into somebody else's ministry? Like, isn't there a minister of national languages and so on? So will this English training sort of cross paths? And then how do you resolve that?
No, not certainly. I mean, that there is a minister of national languages.
Yeah.
There are the main focus is teaching Sinhalese and Tamil for the communities. Certainly, I mean, if they are also teaching English, education ministry teaches English, higher education ministry can do.
Yeah.
I mean, I don't think English has to be a language that should be household.
A somewhat regular viewer has sent this question in. 1970, the English medium was scrapped. Up to now, GCE O-level is only in Sinhala and Tamil for primary language. Is there a possibility of bringing English for GCE O-level as a primary language?
Well, now, presently, the GCE O-levels can be done in English medium.
Hmm.
But, I mean, if English is someone's primary language,
yeah,
that should be allowed. That's what I believe in.
Mm-hmm.
But if you take majority of Sri Lankans,
yeah,
it is only a handful whose primary language is English.
Mm-hmm.
So, and also I believe in a country like we are in Sri Lanka, for us to learn, we have to learn our culture. We have to like be proud of our heritage. For us to be proud of our heritage and for us to learn our culture, I believe students should initially learn in their vernacular as well. Like you're a Tamil, you should have a fair knowledge of Tamil.
Hmm.
If you're a Sinhalese, you should have a fair knowledge of Sinhalese. On top of that, you have to learn English, and also in time to come, not only English.
No, that's true.
There are other languages that you should certainly learn.
Yeah.
But you should not, you know, if you completely forget your language, forget your roots, we will collapse as a nation. Sri Lanka is such a strong nation because of our cultural heritage that we have to understand.
Yes, it's all well and good, but knowing all that, but really, we need to be able to express our gratitude and our pride in our historical background in a language that is understood internationally.
Absolutely.
And so it's absolutely essential. And I mean, I notice that we have all sorts of schools. I mean, there's an Institute of Banking Studies. I think the central bank's done that. And perhaps if all these institutes are functioning properly, there would have been no need for us to go to Singapore in search of a governor of the central bank. I just thought I'd bring the bond in.
Yeah.
Because that's important.
But
it's not a joke, really.
Yeah.
Do you know what I mean?
Yeah. No, but there are competent people in Sri Lanka who can handle.
Of course.
Any position.
Absolutely.
I mean, it's a decision finally of the person who appoints to appoint a Sri Lankan or appoint an outsider.
Yeah.
But I am of the opinion there are enough competent, educated people who can handle any position in Sri Lanka within the country.
And do you think that we should allow overseas people to come here unless they have very specialist skills.
No, but if they are, certainly if they are Sri Lankans,
yeah.
and if they would love to come back to Sri Lanka,
well, that's a given.
Having,
that, yeah,
yeah, having obtained.
What I'm saying of people who are not of Sri Lankan origin.
No, I mean, certainly, unless it's very important, if it's an expertise that is not available in Sri Lanka.
Yeah.
I believe there are enough Sri Lankans, even outside Sri Lanka. The issue is the income that they gain there is not comparable to what they can earn here.
Hmm.
So, if they can be paid something reasonable, I mean, there are a lot of people who would like to come to Sri Lanka not for the amount that they're earning there, but for a reasonable salary. Hmm. I think we should encourage them to come back to Sri Lanka if they would like to come, because they are experienced, they're educated, and they've seen the world. They know they are people who have turned countries around.
Yeah.
We must invite them to Sri Lanka to contribute towards our success.
Some people have come here and they find that they want to do politics, but they can't because they're foreigners.
Yeah.
So, on the other hand, you're inviting them to come here and invest their money and so on, but if some of them want to do a national service in terms of enter politics, they'd have to then give up their overseas citizenship. Does that sound fair to you?
Well, it's like this. Now, what now? As there are 21 million Sri Lankans in this country.
Yeah.
Majority of them, 99% of them, are only Sri Lankans.
Yeah.
They don't have any interest outside.
Yeah.
So they would, I mean, what is important in politics is how people would look at things.
Yeah.
Now, they would, if they feel suspicious
yeah.
of a person's movement, if they think, look here, we want our country to develop. This guy has come from wherever he has his...
Are you proud of being Sri Lankan?
I am, certainly.
Yeah?
I am.
Did you ever consider leaving?
No. I will not.
Are you happy with the situation now?
Well, this is my country.
Yes.
There are issues I can't say.
So you want to sit here and fix it?
But
you want to sit here?
Absolutely, and fix it, yeah.
yeah.
Because this is my country. I'm proud of being a Sri Lankan. We have issues. We had serious issues, like during the time.
What are the kind of issues you're having with our dear Prime Minister?
Well, being in the cabinet, I should.
Collective responsibility.
Raise a collective responsibility. Yeah. So I should raise my concerns inside the cabinet,
yeah.
whatever that I have.
Yeah.
But there are issues.
Yeah.
Certainly, there are issues of the governance. There are issues with individuals. There are issues with certain institutes, certain proposals. There are, but we are trying to. I mean, this is a joint government. This is a government where two main political parties are together to run the government. So, like policies differ, ideologies differ. We have various like SLFP thinking is.
You're an SLFP.
Yeah.
And where are your loyalties?
To the party.
To the party.
To my party and to my party policies.
And in terms of the former president and the current president, where are your loyalties?
When I joined the party, Mrs. Bandaranaike was the leader.
So your loyalties were with her?
With her. And then when she handed over the party to Chandrika Bandaranaike Kumaratunga, I was with the party. My loyalties 100% stood with the leader.
Right, with then the leader of the party. So your loyalties today are with whom?
With the present leader, the present president of the country. Absolutely, 100% my loyalties are towards my leader and towards my party.
That's wonderful. do you agree with one of our viewers who says, if we can groom somebody to be the Prime Minister or the President,
yeah.
That would be the whole country would benefit. Do you think that grooming process is happening at the moment?
Well, it's, I mean, you can't like create leaders.
Right.
You outsiders like no one can, now A cricketer can be groomed.
Yeah.
A hairdresser can be groomed.
Yeah.
Even a lawyer can be groomed.
Yeah.
But not a leader. Leader, of course, certainly there are certain things that the party can do.
Yeah.
Party can offer them an equal platform.
Yeah.
Party can, people can give them opportunity.
Right.
It is up to the candidates to be groomed on their own. I think there is platform available. People will finally pick who.
Indeed. There's a very skeptical viewer. We'll leave the program with that one then. Who says politicians don't leave the country. Collective responsibility is to rob the central bank. Thank you very much for the tongue-in-cheek.
We are the ones who were insisting on that. As SLFP, together with the president, we insisted that there has to be a proper, fair inquiry and a presidential commission should be set up.
Can I ask a personal question quickly, because we're at the end?
Yeah.
Do you think the Prime Minister should submit himself to give evidence before the commission?
Well, he has sent his
clarifications.
Yeah, he has sent me. That is what the commission has asked for.
Yeah.
If the commission wants him to come, there is no option, alternative, he has to go.
But what do you personally feel?
Well, I shouldn't express my personal opinion, because it could amount to...
Chandimavirakodi, thank you very much. Do you know there are vacancies in the Foreign Office?
Yes.
You might want to become a diplomat as well, because it's a great answer. but thank you very much for being here. We do appreciate the brutal honesty of it all. Thank you. And that's about it from Newsline on Tuesday, the 24th of October. Take care. God bless.
Thank you.
Newsfirst, Newsline with Faraz Shaukat Ali.